Yo, Loyiso Gola here. Today I'm having a conversation with Hasan Minhaj, who I haven't seen in a while. I chat to him online, but I haven't seen him in a while. Last time I saw you, Hasan, we were in North Carolina.
Yeah.
The last time I saw you in North Carolina. I tell you the craziest thing that happened to me. Nothing happened to me in North Carolina. I thought it was a very crazy, it was a weird place for me. It didn't look like a place I would want to live in, number one. But at the time, I was vegan. And so I would go to this vegan place all the time. Like, I would leave the hotel in the morning, go to this vegan place. And the last time I went to the vegan place before I jumped on my flight, Nipsey Hussle was there. And he was... I mean, listen, I know of Nipsey Hussle's music and stuff. And he was there. And I generally don't like bothering people. And he was ordering all this food. And he was like with like six dudes and they were videoing the stuff. And I remember like just sitting there and going, should I just say, hey, what's up? Showing love from South Africa. I was like, nah, let me leave this dude alone. And then like literally maybe like four weeks later, he passed on. So that was my very odd, very odd North Carolina experience. How you been?
I've been good, bro. I've been good. This is one of those things where I always, you know what I love most about you? You're one of my few friends that will straight up FaceTime me out of the blue. Like, bro. And what I love about that move is the audacity.
Yeah.
Like, no. We're not texting. We're not calling. Bro, I need to see your face right now.
It's because sometimes we don't see things the same way. I've learned that's a bit intrusive now. I've been told like, yo, don't do that. And then I go, okay, I won't do it. But I just be like, yo, it's just, I'm FaceTiming you.
Good.
I still do it sometimes, but I'm aware that I'm being intrusive.
But now, I like the intimacy of it. I kind of like the move. The boldness of the move, I'm like, yo, nobody does this. So I respect the bold move to the basket.
And it's so crazy because you just pick up as well. You're like, yo, what? Okay, I guess, whatever.
Yeah. That's the equivalent of no condom of a social interaction vis-a-vis phone call. You know what I mean? We're just going to go no condom? Like, that's, all right.
That's
we're
it.
At that
that's
point
it.
In the relationship.
Date one, raw. Okay, let's do it.
It's so vulnerable. How long did it take you to crack the theme of unlearning? Because I'm working on the new hour, which is almost like the follow-up to Homecoming King, similar sort of like 70-minute show. But how long did it take for you to crack, oh, the theme is unlearning? The theme is, I grew up thinking all these things through my mom, through society, but what it really was this. How did you pinpoint that core idea?
I think it was something I was going through in my life generally. Because I was in my early 30s when I started writing that show. But then every review said, this is a funny show, but I don't know what this dude is about.
And so, interesting.
Yeah, so I was like, and so that became sort of like, when I was really frequenting the UK to the point where I moved there, that was the main feedback I was getting. And my manager at the time was like, yeah, they're all right. You need to say pertinent things for people to remember who you are. Because everyone's funny. A lot of people in TikTok are funny. People on Twitter are funny. But if you say pertinent things and things they can walk away with and things that they can, inform their lives, then you start entering a different bracket and wave of comic. And so I started like pursuing that. That's how for me, because I was literally going, I can't continue living my life like this. I can't continue thinking like this. You know what I mean? If I want to have a relationship with anyone, I gotta change a lot of things. And so I went through it, man. I was like, I was raised by traumatized people. So I'm either gonna inherit the trauma, because the trauma is brought upon them by the state and everything around them as a consequence. But I can't let that dictate how I live my life. So I had to like go through this journey of unlearning. It was literally a personal project in that way.
You know what I love the most, man? There's this conversation that's happening right now with jokes, specifically in America, jokes and censorship. Can you joke about anything? And what I love is you take something as traumatizing and as terrible as apartheid, and you just completely flip it on its head, where you talk about learning about it in school, and then you kind of front where you were like, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Where people in the States, when they interview you, they turn to you like, oh man, as a child, you were probably like, you were really in the streets, and you were like, bro, I was in school. Like, I was living my life.
Yeah, yeah.
But you can show how something that is objectively traumatizing and terrible can just be hilarious, can just be a funny thing.
But to the point of censorship, though, I just want to say, like, I think what the people are saying, the audiences are saying, they're just holding comics more accountable, right? So they're just saying, hey, man, just be accountable for what you're saying, because what you're saying can, you know, you could talk to 2 million people in one video, that kind of vibe. That makes sense. And so it's uncomfortable now because it's a renegotiation. And this accountability is not just specific to comics. It's specific to everyone. If you're a corporation, people are going, hey, man, you got to be aware of your usage of water. Hey, man, you got to pay. It's not like no one's picking on comics. It's just that we're all headed towards sort of like this accountable society. And so I understand the resistance, because every change, most changes will feel a bit of resistance. But at the moment, I think there's a negotiation happening between the audience and comedians. And at some point, it will level out. Because it doesn't make sense. Like, think about it. Okay, if you think of stand-up in sort of like on general terms, you go, okay, stand-up, if you understand it, or comedy, is speaking up to authority. Right? So you talk up to the 10%, if you talk to the 2%, you know, I mean, you're talking to the 1%, the corporation, the government, that's who you are.
But whoever that person is, yeah.
Right. And so if you think about it in economic terms, if Netflix gives, if you're a stand-up comic and you're playing in the clubs, and at some point Netflix gives you, let's say, $4 million for your special, you are literally part of the 1% all of a sudden.
Right.
So as a person, now if you're part of the 1%, should you be allowed to say what you want to say as part of the 1%? So it's complicated. It's a very complicated discussion and engagement. And I think at some point it will level out. And I'm more like, all right, cool. I hear what the conversation's happening. I am going to do stand-up that doesn't involve any of these things you guys are talking about.
Oh, interesting. You made a conscious choice. Because one of the things that I love about unlearning specifically is how personal it is.
Yes.
And to me, that's the best gift to talk about all this stuff.
Yes.
Bro, you're talking about, you know, relationships, trying to get laid, you're talking about your own personal shortcomings, you're talking about race relations in South Africa, but it's through your story, so nobody can question it. You're like, hey, this is my experience.
Right, like, right.
I went out partying with my friends, they told me to do mushrooms, they had coke, we had a crazy night. I'm not telling you to do this, this is what happened to me. I love the confessional aspect of comedy, and I never want people to lose that. That's the thing that I think comedy was this intimate art form, and is this intimate art form that you are performing in front of several hundred people, and now people in 190 countries are seeing it. And those are two different conversations. But what I love about your style is, and I hope you never lose this, is that conversational style. You're almost talking to us like it's just a public secret. Like, hey, let me tell you this crazy story from my life. And it's just for you guys tonight. And then you happen to shoot it and capture it for the world.
Okay.
But I love that public secret.
I'm gonna ask you a crazy, how much of that special do you think is true? Do you think 100% true, 80%, 7%?
All right, this is my take. Emotionally true, 80%. Emotionally true, what you're saying was 80%.
Okay.
And I would say 20% came from like other comics, friends, collaborators being like, hey, Loy, like, this is how you're going to land the point. If you actually
Right.
But 80% of that was emotionally true, right?
Right.
And then I would say 60% of it is actually documentary, yo, this was actual real life truth.
Right.
For real, I think the Adhan story, that is 100% real.
The Adhan story is true, though.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah,
I could just...
Yeah,
and then people don't know this. By the way, this is... Yo, keep this in the cut. Please keep this in the cut. A lot of times what you'll end up doing in comics... I'll do this. Fine. I'm not going to put this on you, Loy. What I'll do is I'll find two disparate stories. And almost like a janky Transformers, I'll break the arm off of one and I'll keep the legs and the body off the other, and then I'll combine them.
Right.
So I'll take two different stories and combine them, and I'll find a thematic stitching in between the two.
Right.
Or something that's funny that happened to me, and then something that's funny that happened to my cousin, and I'll put it all in one. You know what I'm saying?
I'll put it
into one cohesive story. Let me ask you this, because the theme is unlearning, right?
Yes.
What was the biggest thing that that you had to unlearn from your childhood to now adulthood? You want me to start? I'll tell you the biggest thing that I've kind of had to crack and figure out. So my parents are immigrants. They came here in 82. So much of what the way they look at the world is through survival.
Yeah.
Everything is about survival. Like, we go to Taco Bell. Yo, keep the napkins, keep the hot sauce. Like, we're never going to have hot sauce again. Like, they come from a survival mentality. For them, defense is the best offense, right?
Right.
And for me, it's about survival isn't living. Like, I want to live. Living means be fearless, swing.
Right.
Have the audacity to, you know what I mean? Really go for it.
Right.
You know what I mean? Right. Which is so antithetical to kind of what my parents are doing. They think defense is the best offense. I'm like, offense is the best offense. Offense is the best defense. Like, you should always swing. And to me, that is something I had to unlearn, because the comedy that I love the most is that way. It's kind of pushing and breaking the hegemony of the way things are done previously.
I would say very much the same as you. Obviously, the survival thing is very prevalent to my life as well. But for me, on a personal level, it was an inferiority complex based on my race. It's just believing that you have not contributed to human civilization. It's only in my late 20s where I'm like, yo, have you been to the temples of the Lalibela? Have you Timbuk? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, so you're like, oh, no. Don't get it twisted. There's contributions, you know, that we've contributed to human existence. That for me was the biggest thing, because I think like your psyche needs that. Your brain just needs that. I'll give you a weird example. Like, American media sometimes is very responsible for one-dimensional stories. Like, I'll give you an example. Like, so even if you're talking about slavery and stuff in South Africa, like in the world, there's only one version of it. But if I told you that there's like Asian slaves in South Africa who were brought in the 1600s, that would be the craziest, like Indian slaves in Durban. Indonesian slaves, Malaysian slaves, Madagascan slaves who were brought into South Africa, who, you know, like Americans have made lives in the places that they've been. You know what I mean?
Right.
So for me, it's like those kind of things that I want people to investigate. And just be like, okay, I see this is a story, but what's the other dimension of this issue? You know what I mean? So for me, those are the things that I'm like grappling with. Because I mean, obviously, on a personal level, I've kind of unlearned a lot of things. But I'm like, just sort of like on a societal and understanding level, I had so much to do, man. I had to be like, oh yeah, no, man, slavery is not just this. you know, this, so it's, dude, I'm, and it's an ongoing thing. You never stop learning.
No, but that's why I think unlearning. You have such a unique position in comedy, because I'm going to be honest with you. I'm lucky that I got a chance to travel as a kid. Just by virtue of having to go see my nani and nana and my dada and dadi in India, that I had to fill up my passport. So I got to go see Singapore, Malaysia, China, different parts of the world that kind of shaped my worldview. The American psychology around race relations or politics is very much a myopic American worldview.
Yeah, you
know
what I mean? Yeah.
When I tell people, yo, there's, you know, there's different types of Indians around the world. You can go to West India, like West Indian people, Guyanese people. They're what are you talking about? And I'm like, no, there's Guyanese people that look like if me and Tiffany Haddish had a baby. And people have no idea what I'm talking about. You know what I'm saying? If you tell people, I'm like, yo, there's India 2.0. It's called Durban. It's in South Africa. It's straight up India, but it's in South Africa.
Yeah.
And you know, people just don't.
They don't.
It blows their mind. But dude, to me, that's such a great perspective. You know what I mean?
The first time I ever went to Mauritius.
Yeah.
An Indian place, but the Indian people all speak French. Oh my God. Blew my entire brain into smithereens. I had to, whatever I had learned about what's Indian and not Indian, my brain was like, okay, forget all of that. And so you're right.
I try to tell American people, yo, the world is a lot more complicated than you think. Think about it this way. I have to break it down this way. I'm like, you know how when you go to Montreal and you're like, oh, it's Diet America, but then everybody speaks French to you? That's how complicated and nuanced the world is. There's places around the world, you know what I mean? Where you go to a place, people are speaking multiple languages, multiple different racial and ethnic backgrounds all coming together. Like, you know what I'm saying? So I totally agree with you.
Yeah. So it's crazy. I did an interview with Tom Papa yesterday, and then he said that you strike me as a person who just travels and does stand-up. And I was like, yeah. And then I said, less America, but more like the world. America's just part of, it's just one of the places I go to
do stand-up. One of the places.
It's not like, yeah, I'm going to go up the country. And I'm like, go away. I must go to, Schenectady? No.
One of the things I noticed, man, how long were you, all right, so this is a knock on me. I guess maybe this is just the way I kind of grew up being super studious and taking things so seriously. One of the things I love about you is, bro, you enjoy life. Like, you'll call me and you'll be like, yo, I'm in London for a few months. I got my bike, I'm shooting hoops, I'm doing shows. You live a life.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And so much of what I ended up doing, even when I had my show or I'm preparing for a special or getting ready for the correspondence dinner, I'll just eat, sleep, and breathe that. And I don't even enjoy the thing. And I'll sometimes see you and I'm like, yo, he's in London and he's experiencing all of it. Fashion, clothes, food. Have you always been that way? Or did you get to a point where you're like, bro, I gotta enjoy this?
There's a quote that really shook me a little bit. And it shaped my whole existence. It went to the tune of, your best project in life is your life. So who do you want to be? And I'd always just want to be a dude who's in the world. I've always just been like, but luckily I had a thing called stand-up that could take me to the world, but I'd always felt that.
Right.
I'd always felt like I don't belong to one place. I belong in the world. Like I could be in Copenhagen. I could be in Chicago. I could be in Nairobi. And I should just be there and experience that and do whatever I'm doing there. And, you know, and leave and go somewhere else. Great life, but hard for relationships. Ooh. It just doesn't work. I'm always, you know, I'm going to leave. Hey, hi.
Yeah.
Hi, Mandy. Nice to meet you. I'm going to leave.
It's so funny. It's like, during the special, you have that election night story, which is supposed to be, which again, this is what I love about your story.
That story is true, by the way.
Oh, that was my guess. I'm like, yo, this feel, because of the way that, how uncomfortable the audience was, I'm like, oh, this is real.
No, it was, I couldn't believe it. I couldn't believe it. I couldn't believe that the room was crying. I was like, what? What? And they was, it's coming to, and I had a meeting the next day, and I remember the city being so good. I mean, New York is a tough, gritty place anyway.
Yeah.
I remember the next day, it was quite gloomy, and everyone, you know, it was the gloomiest day in New York, and I got to the meeting, the place, it was my second meeting at this place, the mood was, I just couldn't,
right.
I was just like, really?
It must be so hard for you because you've seen political unrest and then everybody in this general meeting, like this general Hollywood meeting is like, you know, the country, we need to recover.
He's like,
we're in a state of mourning. And
come on, man, it'll be fine. But it was a disaster of a, it was a disaster of a presidency, I must say.
Yeah. No, but I love how you couched that whole story, which is an election night story, into a date night story. I love the bait and switch in that. You know what I mean?
It's so crazy because this girl was an immigrant, I think. Was she? Yeah. She was from, oh my God, where was she from? I don't remember. I don't remember where she was from. Where she... But I was like, why do you care so much? You're not even American.
Right. She's like, I have my green card, but I care.
But also, I think as a South African, I'm like, I can always go home. I don't have that thing of, I just go, yeah, I'm going to go home, whatever. I just have that thing. I don't have like, I need America, Great Britain to do well for me to feel good. I'm just like,
but Loyiso, we're comics. We're the original pirates. Like we're modern pirates. So we're free agents. We'll get in where we fit in. You know what I mean? We'll go wherever they got a stage and in a hotel, and you know what I mean.
And and an audience. I don't know.
Yeah.
What you're a married person? Where? What was your biggest relationship unlearning?
I mean. This goes back to the survival thing. Like, when you see Indian parents, they're committed to each other. They're committed to each other. Do they love each other? That's a different thing. So I had to unlearn the difference between commitment and love. Like, you can't treat marriage like a cell phone contract. Like, hey, I just gotta. I'm locked into AT&T. I don't really have a choice. And it's going to put me in a financial predicament to get out of it, so I might as well stay. No, you got to love AT&T. You know what I mean? You got to love Verizon. So I had to unlearn the difference between commitment and love. I had to learn, you know? So for everybody watching, I love Bina. That was what I had to learn. I'm not just committed to her. I love Bina. You know what I mean? When you're single and you're swiping through reality, everything is a fantasy. When you put a ring on it, I'm running my own race. So anybody that's bringing negativity into my life, I'm like, look, I got one person to please. I'm swiping left on all your nonsense. Like, I gotta make this work. You know what I mean?
I remember
when I was single, people are like, you're a bad friend or you're, and I used to listen to it. I said, I need to reconcile this relationship and maybe so-and-so. I'm like, yo, the only person's opinion, the comment that needs to fill up my feed is Bina Patel Minhaj. That's it. If your name ain't Bina Patel, there's a ton of Bina Patels out there, but if you're specifically Bina Patel, I know there's like 1,387 Bina Patels out there, but to the one that I'm married to, you're the only one whose comments actually matter. And so the thing I had to unlearn was the game was very complicated. You got to simplify the game. And even if you lose people along the way, you got to simplify it just for survival and love to thrive.
Man, I'm still a single person. But
I don't envy you at all, man. I don't envy you at all.
Listen, if you're single, it's hard. Everything, life is just a... My understanding of life is that it's hard. But by hard, I don't mean like in sort of like... everything, you have to learn everything. You have to learn... You can't just... Like, if you came into the single world right now, you'd be dead in the water, right? And you wouldn't know how to navigate that. I don't know
the jurisprudence. I don't know.
Hey, can you you're standing in the wrong line, sir. Please grab a form and stand over there.
I go to a bar with you. I see somebody that I'm interested in. I'm like, yo, should our parents meet? She's like, yo, you're going too fast. Our parents meet.
What are you talking about? Yeah, so it's everything. If you entrepreneur, it's hard. If you got a job, it's hard. If you're a business owner, it's hard. It's just everyone's got their thing that they do, but then I know for sure that if I was in a relationship in the way that I envision a relationship, I would have to be in one place. And does that mean I can do comedy the way I can do it at the moment? And the answer is no. Right. And it's a definite no. So for me at the moment, I'm navigating that. And I'm just like, okay. But it's hard. It's hard. It's hard, like, it's hard just finding someone and chatting to them. Sometimes you had a weird show in Finland. Right. And you just want to say to someone, hey, that show was bad. Yeah. And I just want you to hug me, and you're not here to hug me. And I just want to communicate that I'm craving a hug from you right now.
What did you have to unlearn with this pandemic? Because we've been on this 14-month long slumber party. And when I watched the special, I was jealous of you because I was like, oh, he had something to work towards and build during the pandemic. You had a marathon to get ready for, you know what I mean? While the rest of us were sitting in sweatpants playing Fortnite.
That saved me, I think. When people tell me about what was happening, it was horror stories. And I'd be like, really? But for me, it definitely just saved me because we started negotiating this in February. So by the time we were hitting hard lockdown in May, I was like, oh, okay, cool. I was piecing things together. I was like, we're trying to find... So it was like there was a light at the end of the tunnel. I'd be like, okay, cool. I'm working to... I would have gone crazy. Also, just the idea of like, what am I doing next when I come out of this? What am I going to do? You know what I mean?
I finished The Last Dance, the Michael Jordan documentary, and since then, I've just been lost at sea.
Oh, really?
Bro, you watched the MJ doc, right?
Of course. What?
Yeah.
That thing kept me afloat, man.
Right.
No. That was, you know what I mean? It was incredible. But for me, it was a lot of like recapping because I remember living through those moments. I remember his father passing away. I do remember that. I do remember, there's a bunch of stuff that I do remember. I do remember the flu game. I do remember the regiment, or a bunch of stuff. And it was just good to sort of like recap and sort of get into his mentality. Have you ever watched MJ's Hall of Fame speech?
Incredible. I used to have a joke about this. The fact that he brought out that dude, I mean, the level of petty for him to bring that dude to the Hall of Fame speech and then just be like, yo, you, everyone thought you would be the man. I'm like, bro, you won. Everybody is... You won.
We are gathered here for
We're
you.
We're all
bro.
Here to tell you that you won. You know what I mean?
Yeah, that for me was one of the pettiest things I've ever seen in my entire life. What a dude. And the dude is old and he's just like, whoa, bro, just let it go. I've enjoyed this conversation. It's been great.
Isn't it sad, Loy? This is the only way we can hang out now. People will call you. People will call you and go, yo, will you do my podcast? And I'm like, all right, that's our version of hanging out now. Do my podcast is the new let's hang out.
It's the new let's have a coffee on Tuesday or something. It was great chatting, man. We'll connect soon.
Yeah, man. Love catching up, bro. And I just got to say, congrats on the special, man.
Thank you, man. Thank you very much. Congrats on everything you're doing.
Thank you, bro. Appreciate you.
Take it easy, my brother. Safe.
Yeah. Much love, bro. Peace.